And welcome back to ThinkTech. I'm Jay Fidell here in Honolulu at 4 o'clock block. And we're talking today about transitional justice, one of my favorite shows, not only because it reaches the four corners of the world, but because it covers issues that are important to the world. Issues that Hawaii should know about, but everyone should know about. Today, we're going to talk about accountability for atrocity crimes in Sudan with our old friend, who's been on the show a few times before, Mutasim Ali. Hi, Mutasim. Nice to see your smiling face.
Hi, Jay. Nice to see you, too. It's great to be here.
It's great to have you. So let's talk about Sudan. And there has been some, action taken to address atrocities and war criminals. Can you talk about what's happening and whether accountability for those crimes, those individuals, has been found?
So first of all, thank you for the opportunity. And direct to your question about accountability, unfortunately, I have to say that we're far from achieving the goal. But then there are indications as to some lights that, some accountability, to be achieved, but we have a long way to go. And this is part of the transition, right? Wouldn't be able to, to conduct prosecutions or trials if there is no somehow political will. And I say this carefully because on one hand, you can see that there is a bit of political will, but then there are major challenges in the country. But at least at this point, there is hope for accountability.
So how far is the investigation gone? How far is the prosecution gone? Where would you like to see it go from here? Particularly for the nine individuals, who have been, charged.
Right. So, there are a number of incidents that took place in the last 2 years. Those incidents involve crimes against humanity, mass atrocities against innocent civilians. And so what happened from the government's end was just to investigate the cases, but none of the investigation committees or recommendations were released. And so basically, people do not know the results of the investigations that were led by the government. However, and speaking of nine individuals, they were members of militia group named Rapid Support Forces. This militia group were established in 2013. And the idea was to counter, to counter insurgents in the region Darfur. And so basically these militia groups committed the most heinous crimes in the region of Darfur. Over 2.5 million people were displaced. Hundreds of thousands of people were, hunted down, were killed. Hundreds of thousands of refugees and their Americans. And this is primarily because of this militia group. And so speaking of this specific case, so the factual basis of this case were in 2019 July, during the sit-ins, the sort of massive protest to promote changes, political change in Sudan. These nine members of the militia group shot at peaceful protesters. They killed six young students, and as a result, they were they were charged for murder, and the proceeding took about 2 years. And then last August, August 5th, the judge gave a decision, and the decision was to convict seven defendants, and two were acquitted. And this is a very significant case because it involved, again, militia groups, members of the militia group, and they are very powerful. They are, the commander of this militia is the deputy chair of the sovereign council, which is the highest authority in Sudan. And so this case is really significant, and it opens doors for many cases to follow because this militia groups involved in many other, crimes against Sudanese people.
Just a couple of things I want to ask about. Number one is, so the people who were doing the protests, who were killed by the militia, they were protesting against the government. They wanted reforms in the government. And the militia is then on which side of it? The militia is pro-government, or is it advancing some other interest?
So a couple of things. People were not necessarily protesting against the government, but rather for, you know, improvements of their situation, right? Like fuel prices, food prices, and all of that. And so really basic things, and for freedom as well. And the militia, this is like paramilitary group. Basically, what they were founded by the former regime in Sudan. And so they are now, they're actually in power. They're not militias anymore. They are actually in power. They're the commander of this militia is the deputy of the Sovereign Council, which is the highest authority in Sudan. So basically they're really leading the country. And so basically they're semi-governmental, institutional military forces, but not necessarily part of the Sudanese army.
So why would these former militia people support a prosecution of individuals who were in the militia when they committed these atrocities?
This is a very good question. And because, as you know, Jay, in Sudan today, there is a trend of, revolutionary movement. Basically, Sudanese people are very well aware of their rights. And so they, since 2018, they began a series of protests, and those protests led to the removal of the former regime. And that gave, sort of built momentum, right, for further change. And so basically, because there is that public awareness, that created a lot of pressure on the government, but also on the militia. They felt have to, to cope with people's demand, because the public outrage was so huge, and there was a lot of international support for accountability in Sudan, because that's the way for to promote change and successful transition in Sudan. And so basically the commanders of the militia and the government found that it is in their best interest to hold those individuals accountable. So basically, which is the saddest part about this case is that the court in its decision sort of refrained from accusing the militia as an organization, rather to say these individuals, they committed these crimes in their individual capacity. And so that's what is a little frustrating, but ignore the fact that the crime or the incidents in Al-Obeid, we refer to it like that because it is an Al-Obeid city of northern Kordofan in Sudan. It's a pattern of number of events. It happened in Khartoum, it happened in Darfur. And so there is no way that you can isolate the event from the incident from the militia as an organization. This is not an individual crime, rather committed as an organization.
Yeah, so they threw these 9 people under the bus.
Correct.
They sacrificial lambs. But, is it okay now, Mutasim, are people generally okay with having this prosecution and letting the militia go along their way and integrate with the government? Is that okay with people?
So basically, for this particular case, the victims' families were happy, were excited about the verdict. Of course, there are a lot of concerns. Because this is only one case, there are dozens of other cases, and nothing is has been done about it. And also, people question the domestic mechanisms, right? Like whether they are effective to prosecute or bring charges against members of armed forces that they are very powerful. They're in the government, and so there's that question. But I think what is good, what is important about this case. A couple of things. One is that the victims' families were able to participate on trials. This would not have been a case if the trial was at the ICC, right? This is one of the positive sides because victims can participate during the proceedings and they can express their views. They can, you know, tell the court what they think and what they want. So that's number one. And number two, it is pretty much the first time for the Sudanese court to deem open source videos as admissible in courtrooms. As you know, Jay, there is no international standards as to how, on the admissibility of open source, videos in courtroom. Even in America, America has its rules. In UK, different regime. In Middle East, in Egypt or Morocco, different regimes. And so every country has its own mechanism. In Sudan, this is where we held as a PEJ, we drafted a memo on the use of open source videos, how to verify open source videos. This is, of course, with our partners in Sudan. There are a couple of organizations, including GISA organization. Just want to give credit to that. And Sudanese Archive, these are the organizations that we work together to draft a memo on how to use open source videos as evidence in courtroom. And so that was has been very helpful for the trial attorneys who led the prosecution of these nine individuals. And I think that will be a base for the coming, for future cases as well.
Well, maybe you can send that memo to Congress, because the Select Committee in Congress is now asking for telephone and social media records on various, you know, people who were involved in the January 6th insurrection. Ha! They would like to see that memo.
We'd love to share that with them.
They're watching right now, Mutasim.
We'd love to share that with them.
So anyway, Project Expedite Justice, which we've talked about and you're a member of, you're a lawyer for, has been instrumental in these prosecutions. But not to bring them, am I right about this? Not to bring them to the International Court of Criminal Justice, but to investigate, to research the law, to advise the counsel involved in the prosecution about the law. So although you're not doing perhaps as much as you would like to do, you are involved at least as advisors to the prosecution.
Absolutely.
Go ahead.
Sorry.
I'm wondering, and you mentioned there are other organizations and other countries that are also interested. What is the comparative level of participation?
So definitely we work with partners, international partners, but also local partners. And so the way we operate, of course, as you know, international mechanism, let's say the International Criminal Court cannot prosecute every case because this is a court of the last resort. The ICC was established to complement the domestic or national jurisdictions, national mechanisms. And so there is a need to strengthen domestic courts to prosecute all those involved in atrocity crimes. And when I say atrocity crimes, I'm speaking of war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide. Because again, the ICC cannot prosecute all the perpetrators. This is one. Number two, in the case of Sudan, I think what we do there more is to amplify victims' voices, one, and two, to build the capacity of local stakeholders, civil society organizations, lawyers, to be able to investigate, document, and use their investigations and materials for accountability, whether that be through conducting trials at the domestic level or regional or international mechanisms. So basically the idea is transform the knowledge to local stakeholders so that they can bring all the cases against the perpetrators. And by the way, the cases, it's not only focused on atrocity crimes, but also all the other human rights violations. And so this is what we bring to our local stakeholders in the context of Sudan.
Well, are you worried that, having these nine prosecution, 7 convictions, you know, conducted now will satisfy the public outrage at what happened, but that the government, especially including the former militia members in the government, will let it fade going forward, and they will not follow through on the other prosecutions you mentioned?
Unfortunately, this particular case is not satisfactory to the wider Sudanese Sudanese people, because it only represents one incident of dozens of other incidents. For example, in Darfur alone, think about the magnitude of the crimes that were committed by the former regime. Think about more than 2.5 million people in the displaced persons camp. Think of people in other peripheral areas in Sudan, like the Nuba Mountains and Blue Nile. This is like southern part of Sudan, where also, you know, crimes against children, women, and elderly people, innocent civilians were killed for no reason, right? Just because of who they are. And so these are big cases. And so, as I mentioned earlier, there are some people, and there are quite a lot of people, do not trust the domestic courts to prosecute perpetrators for those crimes. But at the same time, the ICC cannot really prosecute everybody. In Sudan today, we have 4 suspects who were wanted by the ICC. One of them surrendered to the ICC. He's now in the custody of the ICC. And 3 other defendants are in the custody of the Sudanese government, but they're yet to extradite them to the ICC. And so people want those guys to be, these are senior leaders, the former president, former minister of defense, the former minister of interior affairs. And so these guys, they need to be extradited, but the government sort of, they're sort of debating whether to extradite them or not. And that's a big issue for the Sudanese people. Again, domestic mechanisms in Sudan may not be capable or willing to prosecute senior leaders at this stage. And the reason why, because these militia groups are all over the place and the government really cannot control them. They are the government. And so that's like the main worry. But hopefully for the long run, and after a successful transition, people can speak about domestic mechanism. But again, I think there are serious challenges. These trials are not satisfactory, but it opens a window for more cases to follow.
I think, you know, that's core in our whole discussion here on a show we call Transitional Justice. And the transition is the transition from a country was in disarray with fragmented, violent, with militia people all around, no working government, a failed country, essentially. And we want to transition that country to a more moral, a more equitable, a more just, a more democratic government. So that's what you guys in Project Expedite Justice are seeking to do. And I know from previous discussions that you feel, and I think you're right about it, is that the prosecution of war crimes is really critical to have people believe in the government. And if people don't believe in the government, you will never have a righteous government. That's the problem. So you have to make them believe. And this is the way that Project Expedite Justice makes the contribution. But I want to oblique for a moment, Mutasim, yes, to Afghanistan.
Yes, sure.
Because Afghanistan, we saw, I was just watching Rachel Maddow, and she pointed out that in the 19th century, twice in the 19th century, Britain tried to build up Afghanistan, and they attacked Afghanistan and tried to take control. As late as 1919, they were trying to do that 3 times altogether. And then the Russians came in 1979, and they spent 10 years doing nothing, achieving nothing there. And then obviously we came after 9/11, and we were not able to achieve a whole lot. And so what you have now is an Afghanistan that is essentially governed by the Taliban. You can say the Taliban is, terrorists, but one thing is clear is that they have the guns, you know, and I think that's so in the militia arrangement that happened in Sudan and other countries in Asia and Africa, is that he who has the guns rules the place.
Absolutely.
That's maybe why so many people in the United States would like to have guns under the Second Amendment, because they know this basic truth that if you have a gun, the other guy is going to do what you say. So what we have in Afghanistan is the Taliban has the guns. The Taliban has been guilty of war crimes in the past and atrocities. And they have said they're not into that anymore, but nobody believes them. And I think that's probably right not to believe them. And the question is, you know, what kind of comparison can you make to a country like Sudan that was previously overridden by militia, other countries too, and Afghanistan? Is there a difference? What comparison would you make?
Sure. So first of all, thank you for bringing this Afghani issue. I think this is really important. And my empathy with Afghans, children and women in particular. And I was watching a press conference conducted by the spokesperson of Taliban, and he said that they will respect the freedom of women and children and everybody based on Sharia law. And we know what does that mean, which means that women will have no rights and they will continue to be prosecuted. And it is really unfortunate that this is the situation. And of course, it would be very, and you draw the example of, you know, when you have a power, then you can really rule, you can do whatever you want without being held accountable. And so this is exactly the situation in Darfur and in Sudan in general. Taliban, went known for committing the most heinous crimes against Afghans. They continue to commit crimes. And God knows what will come, after the departure of, the American troops and the UK and France and the European troops. I think, we are yet to see some terrible disasters to come. And so it is really unfortunate that, whoever has the power, and that means you have a gun, you have money, you can do whatever you want. Nobody can hold you accountable despite the crimes that are committed. The Taliban now became a de facto government, and for the world to cooperate and sort of try to mitigate the damage that they may cause, the violations that they may commit, and so. The comparison that I will draw between the situation in Afghanistan and Sudan, it is really appalling to see perpetrators that are in power and nothing can be done about them. This is in Sudan, we have this militia, rapid support forces. They were brutal militia and it's still brutal. They committed many atrocities and nobody can hold them accountable. That's exactly what is happening in Afghanistan today. Unfortunately, the only people that have the power to change the situation will be Afghans and will be Sudanese. Of course, it is challenging. They need the support of the world, but definitely, it's hard to see an external force to come and make a change in countries like Afghanistan and Sudan.
Oh, it bears all the marks of tragedy, Mutasim. So let me just paint a picture as it is likely to be the case. We know from the 90s that Taliban were brutal, and we suspect they may be brutal again, even though it's a full generation or more later. You know, people have the hope that the new Taliban is nicer than the old one, but there's no assurance of that at all. And so let's assume for this discussion that they engage in the same kind of atrocities they were engaging in the 90s. And let's assume that the world hears about it, because no country these days is sealed off. at the very least, you find out the atrocities that are going on in the country. So query, what can the world do about that? I mean, I'm not optimistic. I know you're not optimistic about it, but what can the world do? What can the International Court of Criminal Justice do? What can Project Expedite Justice and the group you work with and, you know, that looks into these things and tries to get the train back on the track? What can we do when we find out that now in the absence of the United States and other allied countries, we find out that they're back to their old tricks of atrocities and war crimes? What can we do?
Well, I mean, Jay, unfortunately, there is no good answer to this. It is very difficult question, difficult. I don't want to say it's a hypothesis, really. This is more likely to happen because there are early signs, and these guys are sort of their revenge and they're fundamentalists, and they really sort of they rule on Sharia law, and we know what that means. And so, you know, the only way that we shouldn't, as international community, as human rights organization, we shouldn't wait for atrocities to happen, rather to monitor the situation and take all the early measures. And here the huge responsibility is upon the United Nations Security Council. You know, there are a lot of politics there, but definitely it will create a lot of pressure. And the international community, they should take all the necessary measures to make sure that Taliban would at least uphold or act as a government. I'm not sure they will uphold their human obligations to treat people as human beings, but at least to act as government, not as militia. So that's one. But from our end, as you know, Project Expedite Justice is a small organization, and we try to, to maximize our impact as much as possible. But again, you know, there are major crimes every day. We hear a lot of, crimes and atrocities, and it's hard to focus where to work exactly. But I think what we can do is basically to monitor the situation and work with our supporters and partners and think of what would be the best way to do it. But at this point, I do not think the International Court of Justice or International Criminal Court, the ICC, would be able to do much in Afghanistan. Because in the end, for the ICC to be effective, it has to countries need to collaborate with the ICC. As you know, I'll give you an example of the case of Sudan. The former president of Sudan, Omar al-Bashir, was wanted by the ICC since 2009. To this day, he's not been extradited. He used to travel across continent Africa. He used to travel in Asia and even to Europe, and his no country dared to hand him to arrest and hand him to the ICC. And so it is hard to imagine that the ICC would be able to do something there, but I think it is more about creating a lot of pressure, public outrage, and financial economic sanctions to make sure that Taliban will not harm innocent civilians.
Well, I take your point, and I think inherent in what you're saying is that the first duty of anybody interested in dealing with the atrocities we believe may likely happen in Afghanistan now is to find out about them, to have, I don't want to say boots on the ground, but sources of information on the ground that would report it back to you, and that you in turn would investigate it at least externally, and that you would report it to the media, and the world would thereby know what is happening there. That is step one, isn't it? And if you can do that, then you can keep the light focused on them and hopefully limit their war crimes. What do you think?
Absolutely. So what we can definitely, our job is to, of course, monitor the atrocities and the crimes and amplify, the voices of victims to make sure that they're heard. and then also to increase the capacity of civil society organizations who do extraordinary work, right? They are very courageous and they just need a little bit of a support to investigate and you know, bring charges against the perpetrators. Of course, they face a lot of restrictions and they're being targeted by the authorities and all of that, but they're courageous enough to continue their blessed work, and that's why we support them. And so we will continue to do this despite the challenges, and hope and surely we're committed to end the impunity. Of course, this is not alone, but definitely working with our partners.
It's wonderful what you are doing. But I fear that, it's not only Sudan, it's not only Afghanistan, it's not only Syria. There are so many countries we could tick them off, it would take a while, where we know that that there are war crimes going on, that their governments are failed governments, and people are under tremendous humanitarian pressure. So therefore, I think that the work of Project Expedite Justice is not over by any means. It's only beginning. And as we speak, there'll be more countries. I'm sorry to say, but I believe there'll be more countries in this kind of predicament, more people under the oppression of failed states. And absolutely. So get ready for a long and challenging career, Mutasim. There's plenty of work for you to do.
Absolutely. And we are ready for that. And we are driven by the pain of people, who are being victimized, who are being targeted systematically. And that's why we're inspired to continue to do this work. And we will make sure that all the perpetrators will face justice in the end.
From your lips to God's ears.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mutasim Ali. It's wonderful to talk to you. I'm encouraged and I really appreciate what you're doing.
Thank you very much.
We'll have to talk again soon.
Absolutely. Appreciate it. Thank you, Jay.
Aloha.